Hi, everyone. Welcome back to Uncensored. I'm Mariam from Yachts Mermaids, your host. And today I have Mr. Matt, who is a former seafarer, captain, Navy, superintendent, intendant. He has done it all, basically. And now he's also part of his company creating toilet papers that actually give a shit about the environment and you. And the company's name is Tanki. Welcome, Matt. Thank you for being here with us today.
Hello, darling. How are you?
I'm great. Thanks for asking. So I previously to start recording, I was talking to Matt and like, holy fuck, like he has so much wisdom to share that I said already, like you're coming for the next, like for our next episode. But one thing that really hit home when he was talking to me and he was sharing was that he's very passionate about suicidal awareness within, especially the maritime industry, because he has experienced this in the industry. And I mean, I actually went through suicidal depression. So I know exactly what that is from the other side. So yeah, let's talk a little bit about that and share your experience with that.
Well, there we go. So you went through it yourself?
Yeah.
Okay. So you might recognize some of what I'm going to say. I went through it myself, and I with me it was more to do with the fact that I was.
It's so crazy. I'm like smiling when you said you went through it. I'm like, yeah.
It's weird. It's really weird because with suicide stuff, people just kind of get very they kind of portray it in black and white graphs, which is super boring, isn't it? And suicide's not super boring. It's a terminal illness for many people. And I was lucky that, you know, I was saved. Because I wasn't asking for help. I decided logically, and this is the thing with suicide, it's about logic. Mm-hmm. I decided that I've had a fantastic life. I'm not liking this bit. I don't see much in the future, so I'll end. And it felt fine. It felt like a good decision. I don't know how it felt with you, but
for me, it felt more of like a sense of like desperation, if that's even a word in English. Like I was so desperate to just not deal with whatever I was feeling for so long that it was almost this sense of like.
It's like the logical end.
Yeah.
At the time, it makes sense.
Exactly. It was like, you know, obviously none of this is working. So like, I want out, you know, like it's going to happen anyway, you know?
Yeah. Do you think that I can remember once I was suicidal and I phoned a helpline. Oh my God. My God. They were almost like, talking me into it.
Oh my God, no.
They were just going, you know, you found them out. I'm really, I don't want to kill myself. I'm like, oh. And you're like, what do I say now? But I do. Oh, and how does that make you feel? Well, I want to kill myself. Oh. And it was just like, it was so shit. It was so shit. It was just like the most pointless things. These helplines just don't help at all.
Hey guys, just a quick side note, just because Matt didn't feel that the helpline helped him, although it did, because if not he wouldn't be here with us today, I want to encourage you to do use them yourself if you need to, or share them with others. Ice One has done an amazing job at creating one for us Yachties. I will post the information below the video, and also after this slide you'll find it. So, you know, I just want to make sure that you understand that the helplines do work, and to reach out for them, because there are really important support available to us today.
In the main. You know, what we need to do is look at the root causes. You know, what is it that made you get there? What is the road that carries you to feeling like the most logical thing to do is to kill yourself. Why do you think that you can't do anything beyond that? And that's something that I'm really keen to look at. And it's one of the big problems in maritime, so in yachting and in the merchant navy, and the Royal Navy as well. These are the armed forces. You know, it's about breaking that logic. It's very deep, isn't it?
Yeah, and I think, you know, like inside the maritime industry especially, you know, suicide is something that you don't talk about.
You know, nobody talks about
it's so taboo. It makes people feel very uncomfortable. That's probably the reason why people don't want to talk about it.
I went to a conference and I talked about suicide in maritime, and people sat there and went, no, there is no suicide in maritime because maritime is so fun.
I mean, yeah, for the
working in maritime is fun. It is,
absolutely.
Super fun. It's super cool. But you're also completely isolated, and also you are not yourself. When you're on a ship or a boat, you're like an actor.
Yes.
And you never get the opportunity to be you. And you only get that opportunity for that time when you're on leave, when you're on holiday. It's so interesting how people perceive it and see, you know, the issues. But it's fun. But we must sort it. We must solve this thing, because it's, you know, suicide at sea is the biggest cause of death at sea at the moment, and we must solve it without, you know, talking, you know, bollocks about, you know, numbers and data and metrics. Just talk emotions, talk how it feels. And make sure that it's the mariners and the seafarers that are talking, not the calcified gas bags that seem to take all of the space.
So said to me that you had, when you were in school, actually in maritime school, that you also witnessed people go through this and actually did commit suicide themselves.
Yeah.
How was that handled at the time? And was it something that all of a sudden, you know, in school they said, okay, let's talk about this. Let's, implement some sort of action plan if you must, you know.
I have to be honest with you. I went to Warsash Maritime Academy when it was Warsash, you know, which was separate. And I had to say, I had a very happy time there. It was very pleasant, and I enjoyed it. But some people didn't. But those people, the whole point of Warsash was that it was a very old-fashioned idea where you isolated people and you took them away from real life and family and what have you to prepare you to go to sea.
Right.
And unfortunately, sometimes certain people came through that weren't suitable. And one of my classmates, Nathan, was not suitable. It was clear on day one that he didn't have the I don't know how to describe it really, but the resilience, I suppose, not to cope with being at sea, but to cope with the fact that you have to live a double life at sea. You know, you spend 6 months at sea, 6 months at home if you're lucky. But he didn't have the resilience, and unfortunately he's dead. And he killed himself in the most appalling circumstances. But he did get through college and he qualified and he went to sea and he had a great life before it went wrong for him. And the first one was a man who I would still call, I didn't know him very long, but I would still call him my best friend, Matt Truman. He was an amazing man. And I can remember in the first week of going to college, we went to the bar, and you know, he was from Scotland, and I had a really bad Scottish accent in it, but I can get over it because I can say I'm half Scottish. I ordered a pint, and he said, "Ah, you look just like Simon Pegg." I was like, "Piss off!" And you do. I said, "Oh, fuck off, you bastard." I said, "Well, you sound like Ricky Gervais." And, to be fair, he wasn't far wrong, but we became best friends. And but he had his demons, and he slipped through the net. And again, he didn't kill himself. It wasn't suicide. He drank himself to death because he was too frightened to kill himself. He didn't have the bravery, if you like, to actually kill himself. And that was really, really sad. And I've spoken about these things, you know, openly to people. And as I said, I've had over 1,000 people contact me with their stories. And some of them are beautiful, some of them are tragic, some of them are absolutely outrageous. But it's all, the root cause is all about how we treat each other. And how we manage each other, and how in maritime we have a shore-based culture and a sea-based culture, and getting those cultures to mix together, because we don't do it very well.
And to be honest, like, if you're in a commercial vessel, you even have that some sort of shore support. But on yachting,
there is no shore support. All you have is shore-based management. There isn't support. To be fair, there's not necessarily a huge need for that, because when you get a crew together, they support each other. You don't need shore-based support if you've got a good crew. But the thing that I've always complained about is that the shore side are unsupported. So you have the shore-based management who are under huge amounts of stress and huge amounts of, agony, frankly. But nobody supports them. We all want to support the seafarers, but we don't support the shore-based staff. And if we did, there would be a lot less stress being passed on to the seafarers.
Okay. I never really thought about it that way. And I guess probably because I haven't experienced like shore support management within the yachting industry. Except like the manager.
The shore side thing is like a hinterland of management, because there are some companies that do brilliantly well, but there are way more that are just struggling and fighting and what have you. And they need some structure. They need the processes and the structure that exist on ship. If you put that on the shore side, it would reduce the stress all across the board and make people much happier and much more collegiate.
That's really interesting that you say that, because maybe, you know, this could be something that you guys who are viewing this could, you know, start venturing in. You know, and really
we already have it.
What's in
have
the
it. We have it already. We have it already. Before I started Tanki, we had something called Wellship.
Okay.
Still there. In fact, this is the patent for Wellship.
Okay.
And it's exactly that. It's about support the shore-based staff to improve the life of the people at sea. We're just looking for a partner to deliver it. I mean, at the moment, it's there. It's ready to go. It's an educational and an ethical model. It's cheap.
Mm-hmm.
It's a mark to say, you know, we ship things well.
Right. Okay. So you basically have created this platform, and you need people to help you bring it. To
absolutely, absolutely.
Right, so guys, if any of you are resonating with any of this and you want a side project or you want to get out of what you're doing and actually bring well-being to the industry, this is your opportunity right here. This was nothing. I didn't even know about this. So
Sweet Pea is here for the taking. It's here for the taking.
Awesome. And you know, I think when it comes to depression and suicide and all this stuff within the yachting industry or the maritime industry, I do understand that, I mean, I never call a helpline from the Seafarer helpline or anything like that. The other day, okay, I have so many thoughts in my head right now. Let me just like put it all together. So basically, when I was going through it, inside the yachting industry, because I was in the yachting industry while I was going through this, I was getting support from the outside, but they were just feeding me pills and they were just like making me not feel good, even worse actually, but it was even heightening my suicidal depression and the wanting to go forward with it. The pills weren't doing the opposite, which, I mean, if you actually read the thing, it says it could potentially bring suicidal thoughts, which is kind of stupid because this is what you're trying to avoid, right? But there we go. So so I was doing all this and talk therapy and all that, and it wasn't just like getting me anywhere. It was just like basking me on the same shit over and over. And then I found other help outside the yachting industry and outside the Western medicine. And that kind of brought a sense of reality for myself, in the sense of like, they were just supporting me by allowing me to go deep into my traumas and to realize like depression is just a suppression of something within yourself. And then allowing me to bring all that crap that was within me so I could handle it. That this is something that I never really spoke to anybody on the boat, because like you said, most of the time within the industry, we tend to put this mask and we're playing characters and we don't want to be seen as a weak person, especially if you're a head of department or something like that, which I was. So you start playing all these masks, and within those masks, you basically lose yourself. Because you don't even know who you are anymore.
Yeah, I totally agree. And that's one of the reasons I'm rolling a cigarette. I'm going to smoke a cigarette on a podcast. I don't care.
It's me. This is uncensored. Anything goes.
Because it's me. You know, it's, do you know what? Mental health has become, it's become toxic, to be honest with you, because you have to remember that We all have mental health, right? It's normal.
Yeah, absolutely.
Some days we're down, some days we're up, some days we're down, some days we're manic, and sometimes we're really super depressed. And that's the human condition.
Yeah.
It doesn't make you bipolar.
Yeah.
However, there are people that are, and they are operating ships, and bipolar is not diagnosed until the if you're very lucky, the mid-20s. And I say you're very lucky, that's not really true, because if you're diagnosed as bipolar, you cannot drive a car in the United Kingdom during a manic episode.
Right.
It's illegal. How do you define that? Therefore, many bipolar people find that they cannot drive a car ever. A lot of cruise ship officers, in my day, were recruited at 16, because by the time they get to Master Mariner, they're still very beautiful.
Wow.
It's lovely for the passengers. But an awful lot of those find that they are bipolar, because the maritime industry kind of attracts that sort of personality.
And why do you think is that?
Well, because it's about, you know, your master under God. It's a manic goal.
Yeah. So do you feel that if there is, you know, because at least in the commercial side of the maritime industry, there's some sort of rotation. There's some sort of light at the end of the tunnel where you say, you know, I'm putting my 3 months in, 1 month in, and then I'm going to get out and then I'm going to go back and do it all over again. But within the yachting industry, most of the people are basically,
yachting, I remember I stayed for 30 months on a boat. It's worse.
I'm sorry?
It's worse. Oh my God, it's worse. In the yachting industry, access to being captain is much easier.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yacht master ocean, yacht master offshore. It's super easy.
Right.
It's way easier than you know, the education that I had is way, way harder than yacht master ocean. Yeah. But you can still, you call yourself captain, and you can boss people around and you can be a dictator. But your level of education is very low.
Yeah.
In fact, dangerously low.
I mean, at least there's something now. Before there was even nothing. Anybody could drive a boat. It's
dangerously low. I mean, you know, I have an unlimited COC, so I can drive any ship of any size anywhere in the world. Right? Oil tanker, container ship, whatever. But in the yachting world, I am equal to somebody that has spent maybe, that'll be generous, let's say 1 year of training.
Right.
And he's captain and I'm captain.
Right.
It's a big difference. There's a big difference. But the difference is about how you manage people. And working in the Merchant Navy, you're managing people of all different ethnicities and languages, and you have to learn international English. I remember I did my first training course, I did an investigation, of an inspection of a ship. And at the end of it, I had to get some training. And they're all Filipinos. And I thought I gave a great presentation. Frankly, from my point of view, it's amazing. It was like the best. I was so proud. And the bosun came to me and said, Mr. Matt. I said, yeah. Oh, your English is so bad. What? I speak like the Queen. But he said, your English is so bad. But I didn't understand that there was international English. I had no idea that international English was a thing. And it is. And you have to learn it.
Yeah.
And anyway, I don't know why I'm talking about this.
I don't know, but there you go. If you guys have any issues with your English on board, please learn international English so we can all get along and communicate.
Absolutely.
That is definitely a communication barrier for sure. You know, I've been on boats where
this must be one of the most weirdest conversations you've had.
No, it's all good. So, you know, we talked about the big elephant in the room, which is obviously getting, you know, I'm just wondering with your experience, what would you say would be the ideal action plan for the, apart from obviously what you're saying that it's bringing support to the shore people, you know, the shore based people, but within the vessel itself, how can we create some sort of action plan to prevent or at least support those who are going through depression that are thinking of suicide and are obviously not talking, you know, about it or asking for support? Like, what would you think would be the best
scenario or action plan within the vessel and the crew members, right? Like you get, and I'm asking you as a captain, you know what I mean? Like if you're the leader of the crew, like what would be your action plan?
It's very simple. It's very simple. It's deal with the shore-based staff, number one. And this wouldn't cope with all vessels, all right?
Right.
But ideally, the shore-based staff need sorting out because they're untrained. They are unsuitable for their role. Recruitment for shore-based staff, normally they look for 40 years experience, calcified master mariners. They're totally out of touch. But the shore-based staff, they're the guys that put the pressure on the ship or on the boat, and they're out of touch. And so you're younger people in the office, number one, right? Younger people who have experience of maritime, who don't necessarily want a career on a boat, but they go and train, but they want to be in the office. Let them do it. You don't need to wait them to be master mariners to run a boat, because the master is there to run the boat.
Right.
You're right. Yeah. So you don't need a master to run a master. The master is there to run. He's the guy that he decided that he wants to have a career at sea and get to the top there. So break this idea that, you know, you need to have parity between the office and the ship or the boat. That's number one. Number two, the crew on board, they talk to each other and they're friends and they love each other. I have friendships from ships that I've worked on going back years. I love them. They're family. You know, and this is the other thing, is that on a vessel, on a boat, the crew is not a bunch of workmates, it's a family.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is being lost. We must promote the idea that it's a family. So that's another thing. But the most important thing is to consider the time that the seafarer is not on the vessel. Thank you.